Take your stinking paws off me, you damn dirty ape!
Return to the planet of the apes!
Welcome to another episode of Go Ape Podcast. I'm your host, Jon Randall. With me, as always,
Brandon Gehringer.
Brandon Gehringer. Hello. We're back.
We're back.
2 weeks later.
Don't call it a comeback.
We took a break for Christmas holidays and for one other major life-changing event. Congratulations.
Yep. Thank you.
You had a baby.
I did.
Another baby.
Yep. Eight pounds, and she's doing good.
Yep.
So everybody's doing good, and yep. Go Ape Podcast. We're back.
Welcome to the world. Baby, do we want to say her name or no?
Her name's Kinsey.
Baby Kinsey. And so, I didn't know if you wanted it out there.
That's fine. Yeah, she's doing good. And yeah, we've had Christmas. And
thank God Christmas is over.
Yeah, it was pretty good for me. I mean, it was.
You got some sword and sorcery movies.
I did. I got a lot of sword and sorcery movies from the 80s. A lot of bad ones. I was ridiculed by my family for them. Especially my brother.
What about your nephews?
Well, you know my
brother.
What
about your nephews? What'd they think?
They also thought they were crap, too. But which, by the way, speaking of that, my nephew looked at my shirt, which I'm wearing now as well, and it's
the Dark Crystal.
Dark Crystal t-shirt, and he said, "What's the Dark Crystal?" And a golden tear went down my eye.
Really? Because my response would have been fist to face.
I know. What did you say, punk? And then just beat him.
Well, I asked my sister when we spent, we did our Christmas last Saturday, a week ago, because my nephew was going to be at his dad's house for Christmas Day. So I asked my sister, I was like, can we watch Labyrinth? Can he watch Labyrinth yet? My sister was like, she just looked at me like this look of no, because you won't be here when he wakes up in stark terror, you know, of like goblins.
Yeah,
so
there are a couple
so
of
I couldn't show him Labyrinth yet. Which, by the way, she's real mad at me because on Thanksgiving Day, mm-hmm. when we were all together, Jurassic Park was on television, and we were all watching Jurassic Park. My nephew's sitting there watching Jurassic Park. Now, of course, when the T-Rex bit into the lawyer, you know, mm-hmm. Donald Gennaro.
Yeah.
I covered his eyes, so he couldn't see it.
Yeah.
But it was one of these things where I got up and I walked out of the living room at the part where, clever girl, and that raptor completely demolishes him from the side. I walked by, and he's sitting there on the couch watching the whole thing. He's 4 years old. And I went this, I went, yeah, probably shouldn't have seen that. Of course, apparently that night, he had like a night terror, as my sister called it, because she said she couldn't wake him up. He was like screaming and crying.
Shadowboxing.
In like bed.
He was shadowboxing.
And then apparently the next morning, he was like, there was a dinosaur in my room last night. Like,
wow,
so
you really tortured this
So dude. Yeah. So apparently I've caused some mental distress to my 4-year-old nephew.
Take that.
With movies I've chosen to let him watch.
Oh, well. What you going to do?
Well, nothing, because I don't live there, so I ain't worried about it.
Yeah, screw it.
I don't have to deal with the nightmares.
But, yeah, I got a lot of sword and sorcery movies. I got Kroll, Red Sonja, mm-hmm. Roger Corman Fantasy Collection, which contains Deathstalker, and some other choice movies.
Right.
I got Yor, The Hunter from the Future, which was an incredible film. And I highly recommend anybody that wants to have their mind blown.
That's Y-O-R.
Y-O-R. Just watch the trailer, and I think you'll see what I'm talking about. I got, did I say Willow?
I didn't say Willow
on Blu-ray. I got Beastmaster?
I don't think you said Beastmaster.
Yeah, Beastmaster.
Korean version.
It's a Korean version of Beastmaster, but it's okay. Take off the subtitles. And yeah, I mean, it was a good Christmas. I got pretty much exactly what I wanted, and I got a little extra, a little money too.
Extra.
And what about you? What'd you get?
I got a blender, which I've used a few times now.
Have you blend? Does it blend?
It does blend. So I've made smoothies on a few occasions now. Like, that's what I'm having for breakfast instead of, like, mm-hmm, you know, like, mm-hmm. going somewhere, you know, something like that. And then, like, you know, I make enough to where it's, like, it fills up, like, a whole, like, you know, probably 10-ounce glass, 11, 12-ounce glass, something like that. And then I've got extra, too. So I'm, you know, drink all that. I'm pretty full, you know, before I go to work.
Okay.
So that's been good. I got some, a couple comic books. My sister got me the Don Rosa, Scrooge and Donald Duck collection.
Cool.
Volume 1 and 2, like, box set. She got me that. And then I got movies, same as you, except my movies are a little bit more current.
I did get Dawn of the Planet of the Apes.
Yeah. I picked up, what did I get? I got Dawn.
Mm-hmm.
I got Godzilla, Oblivion. Yeah, a few movies like that. So,
oh, good.
Stuff like that. Got a game for my PS4, Killzone.
Yeah, you're all over it. We got a lot of games now.
And no PlayStation Network to play them on.
No PlayStation Network to play them on.
Thanks a lot, hackers.
Well, they're stupid. But I've got other games to play. And
my primary suspect, by the way, if you're listening, Sony, is the girl from Jurassic Park.
Yeah.
She was a hacker.
She is a hacker.
So look for Lex.
We're called hackers.
So I told you I don't like to be called that. I'm a hacker.
Ugh. And that operating system that never existed, nor Linux. Did it in the future. Yeah.
Linux.
Well, it had like squares or some trash. We got to do a couple of...
Polygons.
Yep. We have to do a couple of...
corrections?
One correction. Well, one's a clarification.
Clarification.
And the other thing is a correction. And okay. An apology and a thing that I got wrong. First, robust does mean strong. So I was correct on that. It doesn't mean fat.
I don't know. Oh, I was thinking rotund.
Okay. The second thing is that it was not Angry Video Game Nerd who didn't like Generations. It was Mr. Plinkett from Red Letter Media. Mm-hmm. And that's a YouTube channel mm-hmm. that I used to watch pretty regular, and I do not anymore. But
can't deny he's got funny stuff out there, though, still.
Well, no, he does. It's just the...
That character does.
Yeah, the half in the bag stuff is for the birds.
Yeah, the half in the bag stuff, which is one of the guys, he's really Mr. Plinkett. You know, you don't care for their half in the bag movie reviews because you disagree on several of them.
They're too long, too. Way too long.
Well, they started doing like two movies at once.
Yeah, it's too much.
But yeah, the Mr. Plinkett stuff, I highly recommend if you go back and watch them.
It was actually him who did all the Next Generation movies, and it was him who had the little thing about Generations and how terrible it was. And of course, again, I've already done this on Twitter, but Trey, of course, backed me with the hatred for Generations. So this is a solid guy, Trey. We need to give him kudos that he sees the inherent horribleness in Generations.
I just hate that he's wrong. You're both wrong. Listen, I'll tell you what Generations doesn't have, okay?
Okay.
Generations does not have an Atari joystick flying the Enterprise.
Okay.
Generations does not have a dune buggy becoming Mad Max meets Star Trek.
What about Data's jump? Remember that jump he does?
Yeah, it's terrible. What Generations does have is a lack of lights in the Enterprise. I'll give you that.
Yeah.
It's a very dark ship. Very dark.
I don't know why either.
Yeah, I don't either. And there's stations on the bridge that were never there during the ship.
And like 80 people standing behind them.
So yeah, it does have some flaws, but it's not the worst Star Trek movie.
We'll talk about it.
Yeah, when we finally do the... When it comes up in its review.
Did we decide what
in
the first
thing is?
Did we? Yeah, Goyt 2.0. What did we decide what the first thing is going to be that we're going to do? Because I know we were going to try next Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle movies, but we don't have those all, so we can't. That's not feasible.
Well, here's the thing. I will buy the Blu-ray that's got at least the first three movies on it, because I don't mind the second movie as much. The third one's terrible, but I would buy the Blu-ray that has those three.
Okay.
I've got the DVD of the one that came out in like 2008.
All right. And then now there's a new one that just came out recently.
I don't remember that. I don't remember a newer film, so we'll have to check into that, but I don't recall it.
Well, then if you get those, then, you know, tentatively, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles will be the new movies that we look at.
To start with.
2.0.
Yeah. On Goyt 2.0.
Goyt 2.0. What else? What else you got?
I mean, not a lot. You know, what else is happening in the world?
You lost your fantasy football league.
I did.
But you racked up some money still.
I did. I took a loss in the league. I took second place, which was disappointing. But before the championship weekend, the guy I was going against, he and I decided to split the pot down the middle. Versus, you know, the winner getting 70% and mm-hmm. the second place getting 20%. Or 60-20. So instead of doing that, we decided to split the pot between first and second 50-50. So I still walked away with about 500.
500. That's pretty good.
Yeah, it's good. And I've spent it on some new things in my house. Sadly, I couldn't just go blow it all, but I had to buy things like curtains because I got my new windows installed in my house.
Mm.
So I tossed all the old blinds, and I've gone with curtains now, like an adult. So they actually look a little bit better, though.
Do make sure
they do look better than those things. Yeah. And it lets a lot more room, you know, light into this area.
Yeah,
so,
a little dark at times.
So, yeah, my rooms look better now that they have curtains instead of trash blinds that came with the house.
Yeah, kind of garbage. Anything else nerdum happening?
No. There's nothing. There's no nerd news in the world right now.
All
right.
Well, we've decided to do, just for this first episode of the Planet of the Apes cartoon, and the Planet of the Apes cartoon is called Return to the Planet of the Apes, and we've decided to just do for this episode of the podcast here, just one episode. We'll see how it feels.
Yeah, we'll see how time feels.
If it doesn't fill out, we'll do more.
Yeah, if we have to, we'll maybe start doing two episodes at a time. But for now, for the first episode, just the one episode.
You know, other than that, I don't think there's really anything much going on. Just ready for New Year's to come up, and always enjoy New Year's. I try to drink some champagne. I enjoy drinking champagne. It's probably one of the only boozes I really enjoy. Mm-hmm. But other than that, man, just been watching these movies, playing some games when I can. And, yeah, other than that, just...
Now, how much is multiple children cut into your game time now?
It's not too bad. It's not too bad.
Right.
Well, she's young. I mean, there's not much you can do. They sleep a lot. So it's kind of the same as it was before, but that'll change. They get a lot more handful once they're able to run around.
Now, how soon till your older daughter watches your...
Oh, my God. There's no nudity or anything on it. It's kind of violent. And it'll be a while. There is some dinosaurs getting
their asses kicked. She can't watch Beastalker.
No, Deathstalker.
Deathstalker.
No. She can't very watch rapey. That. That's a very rapey movie.
Within like the first 5 minutes.
Yeah, it's got a lot of rape.
Within like 5 minutes into the film.
Yeah, there's a lot of rape going on. But it's a great, I like it. It's a good swordsman sorcery movie. Deathstalker has a lot of dinos getting their asses kicked. Like arrows in their eye and split skulls. And a lot
in
of
Act
blood.
One.
Yeah,
Act One.
Yeah, Act One. It's a good one. But yeah, that'll be down the road. A lot of those things will be down the road.
I'm trying to think if there's anything else going on. I don't really have anything else. So, I guess we'll get into the episode. Now, we should start by saying a section of the opening of our podcast, which we've mentioned this before,
correct,
is the opening music to the show.
Spliced a little bit.
Spliced,
right?
Obviously.
It's not all of it.
Right, correct. So, obviously, the beginning is Charlton Heston from Planet of the Apes. And then, when the music really kicks into gear for the opening of the cartoon, is when we take that, and that's the part that you hear in our opening, where it ends and it says, Return to the Planet of the Apes. That's where the show would normally begin.
And I originally wanted to do my... I wanted to redo that with my own take on it.
Right, you did.
And instead of just how it goes, Return to the Planet of the Apes! I wanted to go, Return to the fucking Planet of the Apes! But that was voted against.
Well, not so much voted against as that I had to do the work editing. So Return, I just went ahead and cut it up and did it.
To the fucking Planet of the Apes! So, yeah, this is the Planet of the Apes TV show, a cartoon. It came on in 1975, and it was created by the Oscar-winning creators of The Pink Panther.
Now, was this a Saturday morning cartoon?
I believe it was.
Okay.
Don't ask me too many questions I don't know the answers to.
I just want to just go ahead and say if it was, I feel terrible for the children who had to watch it.
Well, they didn't have much back then, man.
Well,
they were like eating rocks and shit.
We just had a discussion, and the fact of the matter is this. The person... who did the musical score for this cartoon.
Or persons.
Worked harder than anybody else worked on this show. Because there's roughly, I would say, 30 lines total of dialogue. And there's like 6 different scenes that were animated. And they just keep being reused over and over and over
again. Yeah, we'll be speaking of that ad nauseum, I bet, throughout all these.
Oh yeah, of course we will. It's the big selling point of the show.
And it is something that, when you go look at critiques from critics and stuff of it, is that's where it gets panned. It was the repetitious use of the same scenes.
Well, I can tell you now, in order for me to keep this show interesting for me, to be able to sit... How many cartoons do we have? 12? There's 12, right? He's counting. One moment.
13.
13 episodes. For me to sit through the next 12 episodes, I've decided every time we start an episode, I'm going to take my old phone... Go to the stopwatch, and I'm going to start it every time there's moments of no dialogue.
Okay.
You know, the constant traveling scenes or the recycled scenes, and I'm just going to let the stopwatch run. I'm going to stop it every
time
he's
talking. That's a lot of work you're
going to be doing. Exactly. But I'm willing to bet that there's more periods of silence in these episodes than there is of talking.
Oh, yeah, I would take that. Yeah, that's about right.
Show's bad.
It's not fantastic, but I do enjoy aspects of it. And we're gonna touch into those right now. So the first episode is called Flames of Doom.
Doom.
And that's not too bad. That's a cool little title.
It is a good title. Yeah. It's the best thing the episode had going for it.
Well, I gotta say that, you know, when I got these DVDs, and you know, it came out in 75, the first thing I noticed about the DVD is that I thought the colors were extremely vibrant for what I was expecting. You know, I was expecting something much more kind of blah color-wise.
Direct VHS transfer?
Right, exactly. Like, and so I do think that the DVD does look really good. It is in... I mean, of course, this is 75, so it's not widescreen or anything like that. So, you know, you're going to have the, you know, your black bars on the side. But I think it looks good. It looks clean. It looks crisp. The colors do. And the first thing that's going to get you is that intro music. And I do think that it does... very much try to recapture, because it has some of the same characters in it of the original Charlton Heston Planet of the Apes. It has that same kind of music in the beginning. It has those same kind of like scarecrows out there, and it tries to kind of grab that old vibe that was somewhat lacking in the TV show, that didn't exactly match up, you know, with the planet, you know, the Charlton Heston Planet of the Apes. So I do enjoy that aspect of it, and I think the music's great throughout the whole thing. So here we go. It starts off, and again, like I said, the intro is very much like the original movie's intro. You've got this NASA pod called the Venture. And there's three astronauts in it, which luckily you don't have to sit through that, you know, using that term for them. But there's a guy named Bill Hudson, Judy Franklin, and Jeff Allen. And these all three are astronauts. And they're in this little pod. And I'm like, how long have y'all been in that pod? Like, there's like no room for them to like move around or like sleep.
And I want to interject real quick. I don't know about the actors playing Bill and Judy, but Jeff Allen's character is played by Austin Stoker, mm-hmm. who had previous ties to the Planet of the Apes franchise mm-hmm. from Battle of the Planet of the Apes, where he played the guy who was running around with Paul Williams and Caesar.
Right, and we try to contact him. We contact him in communication errors.
Well, he seemed to show interest that he wanted to be on the show, and then we never really got any more response from him.
And speaking of people from old shows, I guess this is a good time for us. Again, I put it on Twitter, but the guy who played Dr. Zaius in the TV show, he passed away the other week. Booth Coleman, he was like 91.
Yep.
And so, you know, I put that out on Twitter, but rest in peace, Booth. And I enjoyed him on the TV show as Dr. Zaius. And
go wait, Mr. Coleman.
Yeah, go wait. And so there's that. So the three of them, I just was like, well, this pod doesn't look like it's good for inner space travel or time travel, whatever.
Cramped.
Yeah, looks cramped. And if the guy next to you's got bad breath, I don't see them going anywhere. You know what I mean? Like, you're stuck with this dude. It's like you're having three heads on a body, you know? Reminds me of Holy Grail. You know, well, you got bad breath, you know? Like the big, right? And so Bill's talking, and he's like, you know, they've discovered that man can propel themselves into the future. They don't really explain much more about it, but because of the time and where they're at.
Yeah, they somehow went 106 years into the future.
Yeah, and it says, all of a sudden the pod goes nuts. It goes kind of haywire. And it starts to crash towards, you know, the planet. It looks like Earth. Time's starting to tick away.
Insert Tasmanian Devil sound effect.
Yeah, it does sound like the Tasmanian Devil.
As it's like spinning to the ground.
Yeah.
Keep in mind, through space.
True.
It's making this noise in space. Sound does not travel in space.
No.
But
that's for us.
And it crashes into the planet.
We need to have sound, though. You know, we enjoy sound as listeners and watchers of the
show. Well, I enjoy dialogue when this show doesn't have it.
So. Not as much. It doesn't have very much. It does have General Urko, though. So
he's back.
Well, it's... Well, I mean, it's not really him. It kind of is, I guess. He's got an orange suit and an orange helmet, and I think he looks badass. I love the orange suit. It makes him really stand out differently from everybody. And he is pleading to this council. Now, this council is full of orangutans, and there's a lot of people watching. And this new ape city on this take on the Planet of the Apes is like a normal city.
Well, it's a better looking city than anything that's ever been in one of the shows
yep.
or movies.
And it's more of a take on the original book.
Full of lush green grass and everything.
Yeah, buildings,
coliseums.
Like, yeah.
It's like if you're looking at it from above, it's like, I don't know, man. It's like DC where you see like yep. parks and everything. I mean, like it's a nice looking city.
And that's more reminiscent of the original Bull, you know, book that he wrote. That was kind of like that. There's vehicles.
Bull from Night Court?
No. I'm trying to recoup. All right, and damage is done. They've got planes. We find out later on they've got.
Are there snakes on those planes?
That's dumb too. You're really, really working it now.
Sorry, I've just thrown this.
Because it says right here, they find themselves stranded in a future where apes drive the cars, fly the planes, and wage an epic war on their primitive human neighbors. It says on the back.
Okay.
So this is a different take on it, but it's only different because, you know, again, the movies were changed from the original book, and this is trying to obviously go back and hit that. And Cornelia, you find out that Urko's there. Cornelius and Dr. Z are in this. Cornelius seems like he's high on drugs throughout the whole show. He's got a quotation marks, he's got a sweet voice in this whole show. And he's very kind of on a cloud. We've got to save these humanoids. Which they call humans, humanoids. I'm not sure why. And it's probably just they did that so that whenever I write it down, I'm going to make mistakes and call them humans. Which I have to say humanoids. But Urko is there, and okay, so he's pleading to this council to destroy the humans if they speak. He's like, there's rumors that the humans can speak. We need to destroy them if that's true. Okay. Cornelius he's on the defense of the humanoids, and Dr. Zier, of course, like I said, is there too. She has a fierce unibrow, in this scene.
It's incredible.
Yeah, it's like someone put a book over her brow is what it looks like. Just like pasted a book, a black book on her forehead. And he's like, look, you know, we need to study these humans if that's true. So it's back and forth. And finally, the council rules against Urko, saying, look, there's no evidence of any speech. They can still be hunted as normal for sport. But if they do speak, I've got right here, then they get their asses kicked.
Yeah, then we're going to exterminate all of them, no matter what the cost, is what he said.
And Zaius in this is a little bit more demure, I would say. He's not as cutthroat. I think he's the most cutthroat, obviously, in the movies and the TV show. But he's a little bit less of a hard ass, I think, going through with this. It's more Urko. Urko, again, is just your, you know, he's your general gorilla goon, and he's going to be the main shithead throughout this whole cartoon. So you've got Bill. I've got Bill and the astronauts. Bill, Judy, and Jeff. They're all in this desert, and their pod's in the water. And then here we have the first of many, many issues of the show. Now, they're in the desert. It's hot. I understand that water is obviously salty. They can't drink it, and they're traveling through the desert. Now, I've got here. Damn these long panning shots, because this show really stretches out the suffering that not only they endure, but what you endure with this shot, how long and just slow it is. So it shows them traveling, and they're getting more and more desolate, more and more fatigued, and it just keeps going and going and going.
No exaggeration. I would say, 6 minutes?
Probably so.
6 minutes of no dialogue.
When we watch it again, we'll time it.
And just watching them walk
through
the desert.
And it just starts to... And I will say that I do enjoy the way that the show looks. I do like the way it's drawn. A lot of the apes, lots of times, are really framed up on the screen really well, where they'll have multiple apes' faces all kind of, you know, really squared away looking or having a cool look about them. I enjoy the way it looks. I think it looks good, especially for its time period. And they do some artistic colors and stuff like that with it, and that was, you know, popular in the time. But there's a gorilla that spots them, but I guess, but nothing ever really comes of it, does it? It's just a gorilla pop up behind a rock, and you think, uh-oh.
And then it goes to commercial.
Yeah, it goes to commercial.
And then it's ignored.
Yeah, it's ignored. And so you see the ruins of a bridge. It looks like the Brooklyn Bridge. And
so most likely we're back around the New York area.
And I guess they didn't see it because they never like said, hey, look, there's a bridge. You know what I mean? Like, it's completely...
Yeah,
they didn't do that. And so it was just a shot for us, I guess. Again, I've got here, desolate for food and water, as they're becoming more and more trounced by the elements. And
they've shed their metal watches.
Yeah, they obviously burn in the hot sun, and their canteens. And you you remarked something about...
I did say that.
You did. I forget. All right. You said something that I was like, I should have written that down, but I was too busy writing other stuff down. Judy's given up, pretty much. She's like, here, take this ring.
She's dead weight.
Yeah, she's dead weight.
I know that. They were dragging her through the desert.
She was like, give this ring to my sister. I'm like, that's pretty optimistic. You know what I mean? That not only are you going to get off this planet, but you're going to go back in time and give this ring to your sister. But whatever. She's probably delirious from the heat. You know what I mean? But her hair stays nice and coiffed throughout the whole scene.
It looked amazing.
Yeah, it looked good. All of a sudden, rock slide, Jonathan. There's a huge rock slide. So they got to get out of the way of that.
Yep.
And then right after that, a huge wall of fire shows up. And of course, my savvy of Planet of the Apes, I immediately go, mutants.
Mutants.
Mutants, yeah. Thank you, Mystery Science Theater 3000, the movie. And so there's this wall of fire. Somehow the wall of fire destroys their packs, which I guess they left on the ground. Burns up their packs.
Which, that's my thing. I don't think it really did. It gave the illusion that it destroyed their packs, and then they just left their packs behind
because
they thought they'd been destroyed.
I think it was an easy way for them to not like to kind of go in with the other humans that you're going to see later on in the episode, even though they've got such nice tailored and colorful clothing on that separates them from the other humanoids, I would say. So I got, again, these guys are FUBAR. Now they're like, oh, man, our stuff's trapped. And then all of a sudden, out of nowhere, lightning strikes. So they're getting all these elements, right? Lightning. And then all of a sudden, there's an earthquake. The ground splits open. Ground splits open. Judy falls into a crevice, and the ground seals back over her.
KO, Judy.
Yeah. I'm like...
She's gone.
I'm like, well, that's the end of her. But I'm sitting there, and of course I know, because my vast knowledge of Beneath the Planet of the Apes, mutants. And you've already... That's already... And I will say, that is a big step forward for me in the enjoyment of this TV show. I mean, this cartoon. And because you got me on that whole TV show cartoon thing, and I'm starting to do it, and you are an ass. All right. So
cartoon's still a TV show, dude.
I know, but god dang.
It is.
So in my mind, to try to separate them, you know what I mean? I've got to say that this is a cartoon. I'm gonna get confused. I'm getting old.
Look, we're just all... Just everybody remember, this is a cartoon we're talking about.
Yeah, we're talking about a cartoon. So they see a bunch of ape faces carved into the mountain. It looks kind of like Mount Rushmore.
Don't investigate.
No. They're just like, what?
Who would... They said, who would carve... What kind of people would carve apes into a mountain?
And apes with, like, helmets and stuff on.
And then they're like, yeah, let's get out of here.
It looks pretty cool.
Let's keep moving.
Yeah.
Like, they don't even go to investigate it. They see it off in the distance, but like, nah, we don't have time to go investigate this. It's the Mount Rushmore of apes, but we don't have time for this.
Which I think looks really neat, and it's a cool, again, that would be something that would be neat to see in the movies, of something like that. You know what I mean? Like, mm-hmm. So they see some caves with some humans out in front. They yell out to them, help! We're all fucked up! You know what I mean? Like, help us out! We're trash! And there's a scramble amongst these humanoid, and they look like cave people.
Do they ever?
And there's a scramble, and you see the scramble over and over again.
And again.
And it keeps on using the same scramble.
And again.
And
just saw it again.
Yep. And then they, Bill and Jeff, they're kind of KO, and they kind of wake up, and it's that scene where they're being Elrond, you know. You know, where they're like, you know, they're taking care of Bill and Jeff. So they went up there and got him, obviously.
So those colorful clothes they're wearing.
Oh, yeah.
Like, we've never seen blue and red.
Bill's got a bright blue shirt on.
White pants.
Jeff's got a red turtleneck. He must be in hell in this desert with his turtleneck. And I think he's got white pants. Yeah, he's got white pants. And...
By the way, their pants stay white for the entire series.
They do.
Kudos to them.
And they look like they have been like poured onto their body. They're so freaking tight.
What was the 70s?
It was. I mean, it's very
they left
tight.
In the 70s.
Very tight.
So, bulges. Yes,
it's quite pronounced. So there's a female there, easy on the eyes. All right, of these humanoid caveman people, and she has some dog tags. It says that it's Ronald Brent. I say it says Brent Ronald, but obviously backwards. And so. They're like, hold on, there's somebody that's here.
You might all remember her as I used to refer to her as Dumb Mouth.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll give you a second to see if you can recall who that is.
One second. It's Nova.
It's Nova.
Yep. And so this is, once again, it's not exactly...
Taylor.
This is not exactly, you know, going in line with the original movies. It's, again, kind of like its own universe, but it does share elements of the story of the original movies. Because you've got Nova, you've got Dr. Zira, you've got Cornelius, and now you've got these new characters, Bill and Jeff and Judy, and they've got their tank tops, they've got their short shorts, and everything's...
We already said what they were wearing.
Okay,
they don't have
damn, that didn't work out well. And so they're like, you know, what's your name? But they pretty much figure out that there's somebody here, because it's got like his years on it. They find out that there's a guy that was born 100 years after they left. So he got there before them, all right? And so they ask her name. She tells them it's Nova. They go through the whole, I'm Bill, I'm Jeff, blah, blah, blah. And they ask where Brent is, all right?
Tears.
Yeah. You hear some horns, and this is the horns you're going to hear a ton of in this cartoon. These are the apes are about to fuck shit up horns. And so horns are going. Cave people freak out for a long time, as many scenes are reused. Many animations are used.
Picture the Scooby Doo gang running from a monster.
Yeah,
that's what you. That's what they just keep showing.
Well,
it's just silhouettes of people running
in
the cave.
Did you say Bob Seger's in there?
Well, yeah, no, that's coming. Escaping out the back side of the cave. You see that's people right. running out. I think I saw Bob Seger about 5 times right out of the cave.
Night moves.
Yeah, so he had to get out. It was him and the Silver Bullet Band. They all got out.
Yeah, yeah.
Bob Seger. I think some Leonard Skinner's 38 Special.
38 Special were there.
Hold on
loosely.
Yeah. So they all got the hell out of that cave.
But don't
cave.
Let go.
They all got out of that cave.
And you see Urko and his army of trucks and jeeps show up. Now, if I've got to say one thing that gets reused a shit ton, it's these freaking trucks and jeeps. You see these jeeps and trucks.
Hauling artillery.
They do use at some point. In this cartoon, they enter from the left and go to the right. I would say, on average, there's 13 episodes. You're going to see it at least 3 times per episode, this same shot. All these apes in these trucks, in these jeeps. And it's just really well. I mean, it's just too used over. I mean, it's just too much, man. But Urko, he starts calling out, and Bill and Jeff are like, "They're apes, and they can speak." So that's their kind of freak out moment. Again, Urko's got his orange suit and helmet. I absolutely love. I want to get the action figure. I've seen it. It looks fantastic.
Of course, the cave people are trying to drag them away.
Yeah, they're like, "You got to get out of here." One of the gorillas throws a gas, kind of like a gas canister inside, like a grenade. And it doesn't really knock them out. It's just kind of like, kind of messes them up a little bit. Kind of disorientates them and stuff. And the cave people try to take off. They start running through tall grass, very much reminiscent of the original movie, which is cool. And I got apes get cages to wrangle up the humanoids as they pull up some cages to the cave mouth. Bill is captured.
Further exploded on the group.
Yep. And now you've got all these ragged, bearded, long-haired, brown-haired dudes, and you found one human who's got bright blonde hair. Looks like someone put a... It practically needs a chin strap on it. It's so tight on that head. He's got a bright blue shirt on, and, yeah, like...
Tailored clothes.
Tailored clothes, and no questions are asked. So he's captured. Nova and Jeff escape, and they're, like, up in a treehouse. Jeff and Nova are. They, like, find this little treehouse thing, whatever. And then it shows back to Ape City. Again, you get to see its more modern look, you know, which is neat. And they've got, you know, they're obviously got sculpture. They've got, you know, a normal society of apes, in essence. And much like ours, except their guns are, they still look kind of primitive. They look like the original guns from the first movie. You know what I mean? So that's kind of strange. You've got artillery shells, but these guys have, like, full wooden stock rifles. I'm like, okay, that doesn't make sense. It's got Zaius, and he's talking to Zira and Cornelius. Zira has shed her
unibrow. She went and got him plucked at the salon.
Yep. And they know that there's been these humanoids that have been captured from the caves, and he's saying, pick six of them to do your experiments on. And you obviously know, well, they're going to pick Bill, of course.
They're going to look at his clothes and go,
he's a weirdo.
I'll take this guy.
And it pretty much ends with Jeff and Nova up in the treehouse. Bill is captured by the apes. It's got an exit video that plays, like a little exit, you know, clip that it shows on the end of each episode, so you kind of know when it's over. Waste of time, actually. But halfway through, it starts doing the credits. And that's the end of the first episode, Flames of Doom. I think it's a good episode. I mean, other than, like, we just need to take these and just splice and edit out all these extra long panning shots. And of course, you're going to get half the show. You know, it'll be half the time. But that's what you need.
It might be a third of the show that you get.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, that's all that's left. I mean, the panning shots, the never-ending panning shots and recycled footage is so ridiculous, man. Yeah. There's so much of it in each episode.
And, you know, obviously, we're going to be... I don't want us to have to harp on that every single episode of this we do, because it's fairly well-known, but we will be spotlighting it pretty much in every one, though. It'll be like, here's a long plotting shot, I went and took a piss, and it was still going. You know what I mean? Like, over and over again. But somebody really went ape with these plotting, panning shots. See what I did there? Go ape. Go ape.
Go ape.
That's right.
Goodbye.
Nope.
Oh, shows my
so life. That. What do you think about Flames of Doom? First
three
episode.
Go apes is always the signal to the end of the show. By the way, it's like Beetlejuice, Beetlejuice, Beetlejuice.
That's true.
So
I can't wait for Beetlejuice 2.
Yeah, at least it's got Michael Keaton in it. I'll give it that.
Well, he needs work. He's just in a movie.
Look, dude,
Birdman or Birdcage.
He didn't want those scrubs. Okay.
Jesus.
Don't go chasing waterfalls.
All right. What do you think about Flames of Doom? I mean, take out the problems of that. Like, just. You know.
It's fine. For what it is, it's fine. For a 70s cartoon. Seriously, okay? As a kid watching the show, I think a kid would be bored. I mean, I think if I go back to me, 10-year-old me, watching cartoons on Saturday morning, I just feel like it wouldn't be enough.
You had more
cartoons then. Well, yeah.
You had more action-packed cartoons.
Yeah. But I mean, yeah. You're only 3 years older than me. We grew up in a time period of...
Super cartoons.
Yeah. G.I. Joe, Transformers.
Strawberry Shortcake.
So, you know, Silverhawks, Thundercats, Mask. I mean, we grew up in the what is truly, truly like
the
golden age of cartoons.
Saturday morning cartoons.
I mean, it was the greatest cartoons ever.
Pirates of, what is it called? Dark Water?
Yep.
Good stuff.
I mean,
Jason the Wild Warriors. I used to love that one.
God, that's a good one, man. Yeah.
Good songs, too. Good intro.
Cops was a good cartoon.
Good intro music. Remember that? I don't think I remember that. Wasn't there Street Sharks? I didn't watch that trash.
But Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles? I mean,
yeah.
We grew up in the best time ever for cartoons. Like, I'm sorry. We just did.
Yeah.
And to have back somebody, then, I don't know,
this
man.
Is 75, and those people were practically cavemen in 75 themselves, probably flipping over rocks for food. And
what the hell came out in 75? Like Gigantor?
I don't know. Drinking mud puddles?
What's that shit that Thundar. You love? That cartoon? Thundar.
No, Thundar is fantastic. I don't know if Thundar is that old. It might be. No, I think it's older. I don't think it's that old.
You have the entire expanse of the internet in front of you.
That's an effort on my part. Herculoids. Herculoids was freaking awesome.
But see, that's what I'm saying. I think these. I mean, like, I think to me, even too. Those are lesser 75 cartoons.
75 is older, dude. This is older than those cartoons. I think those are, like, late 70s.
Thundar came out in 1980.
See?
Okay.
And they do Herculoids.
Herculoids.
If you can spell. This DVD is in mono, by the way, which is not a big
deal. Herculoids came out in 1967.
Whoa! So that was action-packed, because I loved me some Herculoids.
First episode of Herculoids was 1967.
Well, you're wrong, I guess. Well, you stand corrected.
That's what I'm saying. You go from Herculoids to this.
But I think this was made for people who enjoy the movies, and you know, it was trying to keep up with that speed. But you have to admit, later on, there are some episodes that have some pretty wacky stuff. You've got Monster Bird that shows up.
Super Friends came out in 73.
That's good stuff. Pueblos, you've got that. I mean, you've got mutants that show up.
No. I will fully admit that there are good episodes of this cartoon.
I don't think this is a bad episode.
There's probably like four of them that I really would say I enjoyed. And I'm not going to mind watching again. Overall, though,
this is a setup episode.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, yeah.
When the cartoon really excels is when it's doing its own thing. Monster Bird, again, the mutants, stuff like that, where it's completely different. You got a lot of action. I believe there's also some mountain blimp action or the hot air balloon action that happens later on, too. Very long plotting shots of that, too. But, yeah, I mean, I don't know. I mean, back then, I'm certain a lot of kids liked it. Some of them probably didn't like it.
And for the record, Scooby-Doo came out in 1969.
Gosh, it seems doesn't seem that old, but, man. Scooby-Doo, I was never a super fan of Scooby-Doo.
I used to love Scooby-Doo.
It was okay. I mean, I liked a lot of the Hanna-Barbera stuff, like Captain Caveman.
I love that. I used to like the Wacky Races.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, those are good stuff. What's your favorite cartoon of all time?
Oh, man, that's tough. That's not...
What's your favorite cartoon of all time?
I can't name it yet.
Do you know what your favorite cartoon of all time is?
No.
I know what we should do. We should probably say what our favorite cartoon of all time
you
is.
You like Hong Kong Phooey?
No, it's terrible. You like...
That was not terrible.
It's not that great.
What about Underdog?
Terrible. What about that shark that danced and sang and shit? That shark, remember? I can't remember his name.
Jabberjaw?
Terrible.
He's always hanging out with Juicy and the Pussycat?
It's garbage. My favorite cartoon of all time is... Right, it's tough.
Jim and the Holograms. You are a big Jim and the Holograms.
Jim, it's pretty good. Mask is a good one. I used to love Mask.
Mask was good. I had a lot of toys for that. It was good.
Well, this is the thing. You know, am I saying what is my favorite cartoon now, looking back, or am I saying like what's my favorite cartoon when I was a child? And I'm not going to do that. I think I'm going to do what now that I have more of a clear vision of what's cool and what's not. Because I probably watched a lot of ass, to be honest with you, and it wasn't good. I really like Thundar. I think Thundar is an amazing cartoon because it just does not ever stop. It's completely bonkers. It's post-apocalyptic, which of course I love. And it's a fantastic cartoon now looking back. Probably in the time I thought it was cool, but it wasn't probably my best, my favorite. I really enjoyed... You were a big GoBots fan, weren't you? The GoBots, the fucking GoBots. I really like Mask. Mask was neat.
I can only think of three cartoons for me that at the time that I liked... Mm-hmm. Watching them now, to me, hold up just as well as they did when I was younger.
And those are?
The only three cartoons I can think of that are like that are Transformers.
Of course.
G.I. Joe.
Mm-hmm.
And Gargoyles.
I was never a big Gargoyles fan.
Those are the only ones for me that I think I can enjoy as much now as I did as kids. Anything else, like I own seasons of DuckTales on DVD and Darkwing Duck. And that's because one day I want my nephew to be able to watch those.
Sure.
Like... They're still good, but I've watched some DuckTales with my nephew, and it's one of those things that watching it now is completely different than when I was a kid. It doesn't hold up over time like those other things do. For me, I can sit down and still watch Transformers or still watch G.I. Joe and love it now as much as I did then. The animation on those cartoons was badass.
Right.
Like, it was just great. But, like, yeah, a lot of the other stuff I watched, even though I will still say it's a good cartoon, it just doesn't hold up the same for me as an adult.
Right. Well, some of these cartoons, like Gargoyles, I think I was just like a year or two like past it, where I thought I was a little bit too older.
I was on the outskirts of it, but yeah. I bought like the first season of it, which is like 27 episodes on DVD, and it's worth watching. Like, it's good stuff.
Yeah, it's good stuff. I remember watching. But
yeah. I was also at that point where I was kind of at that age where I was like starting to stop watch cartoons. Right. You know,
I think I've got my list. If I was to add it up, if I could do four, it would be Mask, Thundercats, Thundar. This is a tough choice.
Thundercats was real good.
Thundercats was awesome.
In the beginning. A couple of the later seasons were terrible.
Well, see, I never watched something really, really hardcore. I mean, it would come on, I would get it. Maybe the next Saturday I was playing a video game and I'd miss it. So I never really...
I just remember at some point they had like another group of Thundercats that showed up. And it was like scrub cats. Like they were like doppelganger versions half-breeds of themselves. Yeah, they were like stupid. And I was like, these characters are dumb.
So did I say Pirates of the Caribbean?
You mean Pirates of the Dark Water?
Pirates of the Dark Water, Jesus. Yeah. Did I say that?
No. I don't know. You put that out there?
So, yeah. Thundar, Pirates of Dark Water, Mask, and Thundercats. Those are probably like my top ones, I would say.
And Popeye.
No. I mean, I enjoy Popeye. That's the thing. I mean, I like Looney Tunes a lot. I used to watch tons of Looney Tunes. You know, we're big Looney Tunes
fans. Yeah, I still have... I've got that huge, like, six-volume box set of Looney Tunes.
And
well, plus those cartoons pretty much are banned now.
Yeah.
Because the violence in them.
And they're racist.
You know, yeah. I mean, you know, like sticking a gun down a hole and making it turn around and shoot the person who's pulling the trigger, and you know, racial stereotypes.
That we didn't think about anything like that.
No, you don't see all that when you're a kid. But yeah, I mean, you don't see those cartoons anymore on television, and that's the thing. I mean, those cartoons to me are just classic cartoons. I wouldn't get rid of them.
I mean, I still enjoy Transformers, and I enjoy G.I. Joe. I enjoy all the staples. You know, don't get me wrong. I'm just saying, if I had to choose a couple. And that was all I could grab or watch. I could get a lot of distance out of Thundar. And Mask as well. Mask just had a great theme song, and it was just fun to watch those cars change.
Best theme song, though, probably was Silverhawks. Man, it had a good theme song.
What?
Silverhawks.
It was pretty good. I do like the Mask one, though. I can listen to that one by itself now. And you GoBots for you. I know. GoBots. The fucking GoBots. So, I guess that's... That's our thing on the cartoon. This is the series that completely reinvented the franchise. That's what Anthony Leong said of Frontier Magazine.
Speaking of what people said, and what you people out there who's listening to be doing, we got a new review this week.
We did. Let me fire that up. We just got a new review. It was very recent. I quickly noted it. And it's by James MNKC. He says he's catching up with the podcast. He calls it
welcome.
Welcome. Thank you for your 5-star written review.
We appreciate you listening.
Yeah, any review we get, if you do a stars, we would prefer you to write out something. Praising me especially would be nice.
Even if it's 2 stars and you tell us that we suck.
Yeah, but maybe mention that I'm cool. Superb podcast says, I'm not going to read it all. I do like his use of willfully knuckleheaded, which I agree.
I would say mine's inadvertent.
Okay. I do like highest recommendation. That's pretty cool. And he's apparently going to be very upset if we were to break up the podcast.
Sorry.
It's not going to happen.
Sorry, James.
Yeah, we're going to go a long, long way.
We're not.
What are you talking about?
The podcast is almost over.
No, we've got Go 8 Podcast 2.0.
13 episodes left.
Go 8 Podcast 2.0. Do you not want to do that?
It's still up in the air.
What are you talking about?
breaking news to Brandon. Sorry.
Are you having a seizure? What's going on with you?
Look, number one, what did I do? Number two...
All right.
No. I mean, yeah, we're doing Go 8 2.0.
Just when you think you know somebody, you're gonna really upset a lot of fans. They're excited about Go 8 Podcast 2.0.
Dude, we've got like 6 fans.
But they're hardcore fans. They live and breathe Go 8 Podcast.
We appreciate you.
Yeah, and you're gonna disappoint these people, Trey. Poor little Trey.
Poor little Trey.
Rick Crespo, wherever he may be. Probably incarcerated.
Rick, if you're still out there, hit us up. Yeah, we want to know if you're still listening.
Maybe he's serving some time or something.
You were a loyal listener in the beginning.
At one point. Maybe you vexed him, I bet, with your music choices.
It's possible.
My
music choices are my own. So.
All right. And so, yeah, I'm excited to do. I think you're gonna. We'll hit our stride right off the bat with Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. Your
wheelhouse.
Yeah.
It's my wheelhouse.
Yeah. That's what you're about. So you should be right into it.
I do love
it. I'm expecting you to pull a lot of that weight now. I've been doing a lot for these TV shows and this cartoon, obviously. So I want you to run with it. And let's hear the site. You know, you know all about the turtles. I only know about the 5 of them, and that's it.
It's only four turtles.
There's five turtles, Venus de Milo.
Okay, then we'll have to review the entire show.
I'll do TV that show. One. Well, sure, I'll do that one
the
too.
The Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles TV show. We'll have
what
to
was
review
it called?
It. Next Mutation.
Next Mutation. Venus de Milo.
Well, you've got the Venus de Milo tattoo.
Jesus Christ. Burning off my skin with lava. Oh, terrible. But yeah, I'm looking forward to it. We'll do the turtles first.
Okay.
Turtles first. I haven't seen any trailers. You notice that? Trailers have been dead lately. We can't talk about trailers. I haven't seen anything new.
There's nothing I want to see anyways.
Well, you hate stuff.
I do.
So do I. What are we doing on time since this is...
About 45 minutes.
It's not too bad.
That's average.
You know.
We'll take it.
We'll take it. Anything else you got?
I have nothing else.
You got to work a bunch.
Well, yeah, I'm working the next 5 days. I don't normally work weekends, but I'm filling in for my guys who were off for holidays. Mm-hmm. But then I got 5 days off coming. So I'm taking off.
You had a bunch of days off too, didn't you?
I had 3 days off.
Mm-hmm.
Did
you want to talk about Fleetwood Mac concert?
Best concert I've been to in years. Years.
When was the last concert you went to before that?
Back in June, I saw Counting Crows and Toad the Wet Sprocket.
That's right. That's right. I remember that now.
Fleetwood Mac, though, it was an amazing show. Christine McVie was everything I hoped for. She sounded just like she did
great
in the 70s. I mean, her voice is great.
Fantastic.
Lindsey Buckingham is... Now, I want people to pay attention to what I'm saying here so I don't catch any shit. Not that you people ever comment on anything we say. He is the greatest guitar player I've ever seen live in person.
Okay.
Okay? Like, blew me away how good he is. And the show was so good, I'm seriously considering going back to Atlanta in March and seeing them again when they come back in.
It's very interesting. In March. Very cool.
Like, that's how good the show was. But I was very happy to see the original lineup, see them playing together. And, they played every song I wanted to hear. There's not one song I could think of that they didn't play, that I wanted to hear. I mean, it was great. They played for like 2 straight hours, no opening band, didn't have to sit through any of that crap.
That's cool.
So, I mean, they were great.
But what if the opening band would have been really good if they had one? I mean,
who cares? It's a Fleetwood Mac. They don't need it.
What if it was...
They're above...
Foghat.
Opening bands. Foghat.
What if it was Bread?
Dumb.
What if it was Boss Skaggs? That would have been awesome. I'm a big Boss Skaggs fan. Everybody knows that.
But no, I mean, they were great. It was just... It was a great concert.
Fantastic.
And, I really enjoyed it. Okay. Well worth the price.
Cool.
So...
I've only been to a couple concerts in my day.
Mm-hmm.
I've been to... my first concert was... I was dragged and given a free ticket to a band that was popular at one time.
Carrot Top?
No. That's not... Well, I did see Carrot Top, but that's not a band. Bit of an idiot. But Dave Matthews Band, which was popular at one point in time in history.
Right.
And I was drugged. That was my first concert.
Okay.
And they paid my ticket, and the girl behind me, the show even started, she vomited all over herself. So that was interesting.
That's what you get for that peyote.
Yeah. And Toad the Red Sprocket opened for them, so that was cool.
Okay.
And
that was when they were in their prime.
It was. And it was a fun concert. And I've seen Tool, which I enjoy Tool. I've seen Breaking Benjamin and 3 Days Grace and Stained.
Mm-hmm.
And that was at one of those birthday celebration things.
Right. That the radio station puts on.
I've seen a guy, some people, I guess he's popular. Margaritaville guy, what's his name?
Jimmy Buffett.
I've seen Jimmy Buffett.
He's wildly rich.
That was a fun concert.
Wildly rich.
A lot of crazy people. A lot of good looking people were at that concert.
Of course, it's all old people, man.
They were good looking, though. They were all good looking people.
Were there a lot of people there in Hawaiian shirts and flip flops?
Oh, yes. And a lot of beach balls going around. It was a fun concert.
I looked him up on Celebrity Net Worth, by the way. Like $420 million.
Nice.
He's worth.
Good for him.
That's incredible.
He did play.
I mean, for a guy who's like basically a burnout, like that lives in the Florida Keys, I mean, $420 million.
Yeah,
it's amazing.
He likes his music, man. He makes some good music people like. So.
Yeah, shit, yeah, he does.
The merchandise. It's all about the merch. You know what I'm saying?
Yep.
Maybe I've seen another one, but I haven't seen a whole bunch of concerts, to be honest with you. I've seen comedians, I've seen Gallagher, and I've seen Carrot Top.
Who was better?
Gallagher was better. Carrot Top was great.
Wait, which Gallagher was it?
Well,
one or two?
Both him and his brother were there.
Oh, they were both
there?
Yeah,
yeah. Like, Gallagher walked out on one side, and at one point, all of a sudden, another Gallagher popped out on the side. And I was like, what? We were all like, what?
Did you get any watermelon on you?
No, I was sitting too far back.
Damn.
And it's amazing. He does a whole bit. He does his whole stand-up. And it's a normal-sized stand-up for a comedian. And then the last 10 minutes is him destroying this.
Just destroying fruit.
Fruit, watermelons, pies. But it's amazing how he just gets that attached to him, and that's it. You know what I mean? He shows some props and stuff, but It's just kind of sad that people only think that he does that stuff, but actually it was a real, you know. And he was late a little bit, and he stayed around afterwards for people to talk to him, and I got to get his autograph and stuff. It was great. Carrot Top was fun, and again, it's kind of the same thing. Carrot Top doesn't just dive into his trunks of trash. He does a normal bit, you know, and then he does the stuff, and it's not that long. In
now, when you saw Carrot Top, that was pre-ripped out of his mind.
Yeah, that was pre-roids.
Because nowadays, Carrot Top could tear your arms off.
Oh, yeah.
Just beat you to death with him. Now, that was also Carrot Top before Chairman of the Board, I believe.
Yeah, I think so, too.
Chairman of the Board.
Terrible film.
I've never seen it.
I've seen some of it.
I've never seen a second of it. I'd love to see that movie, but it's never been on Netflix or anything.
It's a hard movie to jerk to, but you can get it. It's there. You can do it. You can jerk to it after a certain amount of time. So, yeah, with enough patience, you'll get it. So
it's inappropriate. All right. I apologize.
Yeah, this coming from the guy who's like, my mom's going to fly me from Beaten Off Dead.
That was a previous episode. You should have thrown out a disclaimer for my sister on that, by the way.
That thing looks like a woman's vagina.
When did I say that?
Remember that role-playing book I had?
Oh, yeah, I do remember that. Well, it did, though.
Within, like, the first 30 seconds, I was, like, mentally shocked.
It did look like that.
That looks like lips. I was like, God dang!
I need to go back and listen to some of our old episodes.
Yeah, try not to
talk. What is this? Episode 23?
I think so.
I believe.
Pretty good.
We're coming up on a centennial.
Are we?
No, that's 100.
What the fuck are you talking about?
What's a quarter? What's a quarter of a century? I don't know. We're coming up on our 25th episode.
It's going to be pretty cool.
Coming soon.
Pretty cool. Probably do it topless.
Maybe.
Topless episode. But still playing role-playing games, still having fun. Glad we got a bunch of new listeners. Apologize for any mistakes that we might have done in the past.
Yeah. For anybody that's new and you haven't listened to all of our old episodes, just understand a lot of the stuff we say is probably only 65% accurate.
And many people probably don't understand that this is completely off the cuff. We don't prepare at all.
No,
you can probably tell that. Some people probably understand that.
There's no preparation to our shows.
No, this is just completely, you know, off the top of our heads. Mm-hmm. I mean, I do a little bit of note taking. Jonathan used to. He's the passion.
I used to.
The passion's gone. And
I do all the work editing.
Okay, whatever makes you happy.
That does.
But we just kind of fly off the seat of our pants, and we create a masterpiece, which is Go Ape Podcast.
I took notes during all the movies.
You did.
I stopped when we got into the television show.
Which was surprising.
Not the cartoon.
I think you figured you could manage the hour long.
I think so, too.
Okay.
You don't agree?
No, you did fine. I think that's about it. Which song do you think I should go with?
I thought you already picked it.
Yeah, I think I did. And here it comes.
Oh, there it is.
All right. Groove to it, people.
This is a good one.
Go ahead and groove to it.
It's Terrence Trent D'Arby.
Yeah, I like it. Okay, so...
He's not dead.
Savage GM on Twitter.
Abe Randall on Twitter.
Great Podcast on Twitter.
And
we're on Facebook, too.
Leave us 5 banana reviews on iTunes.
Yep. And go Ape.
And until next time, go Ape.
I'll go Ape.